Welcome to today's webinar, Carrying Equity in COVID-19 Vaccination Forward, Guidance Informed by Communities of Color. Emily Brunson will now begin.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. My name is Emily Brunson, and I'm an Associate Professor of Anthropology at Texas State University. I'm joined by my colleague, Dr. Monica Shakspana, Senior Scholar at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security. This webinar is an output of Communivax, a national coalition to strengthen the community's role in an equitable COVID-19 vaccination campaign. Communivax is co-led by the Department of Anthropology at Texas State University and the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security at the Bloomberg School of Public Health. The Communivax Coalition, which includes local teams working with Black and Hispanic Latino communities across the United States, the Working Group on Equity in COVID-19 Vaccination, and strategic partners, including the Association for Immunization Managers, was funded by the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative with additional support from the Rockefeller Foundation. Today, we're very excited to share with you the newest Communivax report, Carrying Equity in COVID-19 Vaccination Forward, Guidance Informed by Communities of Color, which was released yesterday. This report outlines new strategies for the COVID-19 vaccination campaign that were informed by rapid ethnographic research conducted with Black and Hispanic Latino communities in Alabama, California, Idaho, Maryland, and Virginia. It provides specific guidance on how to adapt COVID-19 vaccination efforts to achieve greater vaccine coverage in underserved populations, and through this to develop sustainable, locally appropriate mechanisms to advance equity and health. Today's webinar, based on this report, will be split into two parts. In the first hour, we'll be discussing cross-cutting, nationally relevant findings derived from the research of our local teams. As part of this, we'll hear from representatives of each of these teams about how the pandemic and COVID-19 vaccination has unfolded and played out in their communities. In the second hour, which will be moderated by Monica, we will hear from members of the National Working Group about recommendations drawn from the local observations. As a note, before we begin, we will answer questions from the audience after each panel. If you have a question, please submit it in the Q&A box. I'll now begin. The first observation from the local research is that naming vaccine hesitancy as the reason for low vaccine coverage obscures a more complex reality. First, hesitancy involves a range of concerns that can vary in detail and intensity from person to person. For some individuals, these concerns are centered on COVID-19 vaccines. For others, they focus on COVID-19 itself. And for some, hesitancy stems from a long-standing distrust of medicine, public health, and/or government. Second, focusing myopically on hesitancy can obscure issues of access, including a lack of access to transportation and limited hours at vaccination sites that are still preventing people in the United States from being vaccinated. Finally, while it might be easy to envision a straightforward decision-making process, where an individual alone digests educational materials and then moves to act, the reality is that decision-making about COVID-19 vaccination is messy. It is a social process that often prioritizes social networks over authoritative sources. It is not a linear process. People cycle through information and can change their minds. And it is ongoing. Some individuals who have already been vaccinated, for example, are still reconsidering their decision. And that, in turn, is impacting the thoughts and decisions of the people around them. In relation to this observation, we will hear from Dr. Noe Crespo, an Associate Professor of Health Promotion and Behavioral Science at San Diego State University. He is the co-PI for our California team. Following Noe, we'll hear from Dr. Daniela Rodriguez. Daniela is an Associate Scientist of International Health at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. She is a member of the Maryland-Baltimore team. Noe, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Brunson. Buenos dias. Good morning, everyone. By now, we are all familiar with the term vaccine hesitancy. However, to blame lower vaccination rates in communities of color on vaccine hesitancy is incorrect for several reasons. First, it ignores the fact that many folks in hard-hit communities are not hesitant at all. In San Diego South region, for example, which is majority Latino, vaccine uptake is remarkably high. About 85% of eligible residents in this region have received at least one dose. Second, hesitancy label overlooks persistent barriers to access and lumps together the many reasons people have for not getting vaccinated, and it places the responsibility on the individual. This can divert attention away from social and structural factors that contribute to lower vaccination. Next slide. Although traditional barriers to vaccination have been identified, we found a wider set of reasons that go beyond traditional hesitancy. Some participants said that they knew healthcare workers who did not believe in vaccination. This can have downstream effects since those providers may not model or encourage vaccination when on duty or to people who they know personally. One participant was worried about the possibility of financial implications if something went wrong after vaccination. Another participant was afraid of the vaccine side effects and efficacy. She said, "I'm a diabetic, I'm not healthy. What if I get the vaccine and it makes me worse?" We also heard from undocumented individuals who feared of being perceived as a public charge. These individuals avoid any interactions with the healthcare system for fear that using public services may cause issues further down the line. Other participants said that they had no one to care for their children or could not take time off of work if they were to experience vaccine side effects. Another participant made sure that his father got vaccinated, but said he didn't take the vaccine himself because he couldn't risk not being able to take care of his father. Next slide. Other people may be vaccine indifferent, who have remained relatively untouched by the pandemic. This might include people who are self-employed or work under the table, living in rural or remote places, and those whose children are not in public school systems. Such folks do not consistently receive COVID-19 information regularly, particularly if they are not consumers of social or news media. We also learned that the initial messaging about prioritizing high-risk groups may have backfired. Some under the age of 65 and in relatively good health may think that it's not necessary for them to get the vaccine. For them, if it's not required, no action is taken. Next slide. Some are experts at self-preservation. They are confident that they know how to protect themselves from COVID. For example, an essential worker said he was successful at taking all the necessary steps to prevent COVID. So from his point of view, there was no rush to take the vaccine. Others expressed the need to endure. Aguantar is the Spanish term. By necessity, they felt the need to bear up, push through, and avoid complaining about daily struggles. Getting sick is an inconvenience that can preclude economic ruin. Other reasons for not getting vaccinated were people's reliance on their faith versus the vaccine. This may be reinforced when a person feels that formal institutions won't take care of them and thus contributing further to their increased reliance on their faith. These are just some of the main findings from our work in California. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Crespo. Buenos dias, buenas tardes, bienvenidos. I'm going to be talking about the work that we've been doing in Baltimore City with our Latinx residents. And most of our Latino residents are immigrants, primarily Spanish speakers. Some speak primarily indigenous languages. And you'll see a number of intersections between the work that we're, the issues that we're seeing and the ones that Dr. Crespo talked about, including issues of access. So we have technological access where so many of our folks don't have access to computers or smartphones or even data plans that allow them to access the information that's often online around COVID, including vaccination. We also see issues around livelihood access where the people who we're working with are primarily day laborers, construction for men, often domestic work for women, and they cannot afford to take a day off work to go get vaccinated because it means not putting food on their tables or not being able to have enough money to send home to their families in their origin countries. There are also a lot of concerns around immigration enforcement and fears that if they go get vaccinated, there will be police or ICE in these places or they'll end up in a database that will identify them to potentially be deported. Next, and next again, please. There are also persistent language issues where we see both on-site and online activities not having sufficient resources in Spanish to be able to navigate the available resources. Next. But I think one of the biggest issues we saw is that a number of our community members want to get vaccinated. So there is demand, but there just isn't enough supply. In particular, initially, when the vaccination was restricted to certain groups, and either these folks did not were not eligible, or they did not have the documentation, the formal documentation, to indicate their eligibility, like a pay stub. Next. These issues reflect the earlier and persistent inequity and access issues that Latino residents in Baltimore City have experienced. And COVID exacerbated these, which is not new. This is something that's experienced by a number of vulnerable populations in our city and beyond. And we saw that turn into disproportionate effect on our Latino residents, with so many getting sick and showing up to care so late because of these concerns. Non-governmental organizations stepped into this gap to provide testing, to provide food distribution and other supports, but it wasn't enough. Next. We're now seeing agencies working together, government and non-governmental agencies working together to offer vaccination sites where people are. So in their communities and neighborhoods, at churches, places where they congregate, during days and hours where they can actually attend. And I've also included here an infographic in Spanish that's been now, that indicates how folks can be registered for vaccination, both online, but as well as a hotline that is manned by people who speak Spanish in order to be able to increase access to the vaccine. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Brunson.
Thank you both. Both of you worked in Hispanic Latino communities. So I'd like you to talk about for a minute what strategies by health departments, hospitals, community-based groups, and other stakeholders have most enabled members of your local communities in Baltimore and San Diego to get vaccinated?
Well, I can say that in Baltimore, there's been a reliance, and some could even say an over-reliance, on non-governmental organizations that had deep penetration in this these communities. Some of our sort of more standing institutions, like the hospital systems and the state and city agencies, just didn't have the kind of networks to reach out to these folks. And so there's been a reliance on those networks, outreach in particular, but also layering of services. So if there is, so if we're having testing site, try to also offer food distribution and try to maintain those connections with people. Obviously language is a big issue, but also making sure that services are provided or connections are being made in a way that's culturally competent has been really important as well.
Thank you for that question. I can offer three examples. Our county health department and other community-based agencies hired, trained, and deployed a large workforce of community health workers. So this was a major contributor to promoting and increasing vaccination uptake among Hispanic Latinos in San Diego. The other is that county and community clinics set up various mobile pop-up vaccination sites within the hardest hit communities, which included bilingual and bicultural staff. This reduced transportation-related language barriers. And then the last is the state of California handed over large quantities of vaccines to local community clinics so that they can decide how to best distribute the vaccines to their patients. So for example, some clinics or providers decided to expand eligibility criteria, including ethnicity, not only based on age, and that increased uptake among the most high-risk populations.
Thank you. So, and you're both coming at with the Hispanic and Latino communities that you worked with in some very different ways. It's obviously a majority of the population in San Diego in the region that your team was working in, Noe. But this is a minority population in Baltimore with Daniela's team. So thinking about what's happened, what additional improvements to the local COVID-19 vaccination efforts would you recommend based on your research in these areas?
Well, one of the things that we've seen change over time and we hope actually persists as a change in practice is actually an effort for, as new programs are being rolled out, that we're thinking about our immigrant communities front and center, not necessarily planning for the majority and then retrofitting it later down the line, because they end up getting left further behind. And in fact, that example that I gave with the infographic, that vaccine registration site for here for Baltimore City was planned to be both in English and in Spanish at the outset. And that was a change in how our agencies were typically working. And that's the kind of thing that we hope persists. I mean, but it also reflects, and I believe the report talks about this, is you know, there are infrastructure and capacity deficits within our health agencies that make it difficult to be able to have the kind of connection, persistent connection and penetration in marginalized communities. And that needs to be addressed.
Thank you. There's a few recommendations that we can point to. For example, immigration policies need to be clearly articulated to and by law enforcement, homeland security, lawmakers, and public health leaders, and then to the Hispanic Latino community and those that are meant to serve at the vaccination site so that the public burden policy is no longer a barrier or concern. Also, vaccines need to be ubiquitous and getting vaccinated should be the default and the easy choice. This includes recommending that employers make getting vaccination easy and an easy option at work sites for their workers. Additionally, healthcare providers, faith-based leaders need to get vaccinated and promote the vaccines among their congregates and their patients, relatives, and friends.
Thank you both very much. We'll now turn to our second observation. I'm going to go ahead and screen share again. So the second observation in the report that we'd like to highlight is that assuming communities of color are homogenous is a critical error. We do want to acknowledge that commonalities exist. Racial and economic inequalities, for example, or economic and racial inequalities are common in both of these areas. But at the same time, differences do exist. So, for example, where communities are located can also create similar experiences. Urban areas, for instance, have more developed communication and transportation infrastructure compared to frontier and rural locations. Despite these similarities, however, differences also exist, and these differences result in unique experiences. Black and Hispanic Latino persons, for instance, experience racial inequality in very different ways due to factors such as language, culture, and historical experiences. Within communities as well, demographic characteristics like age, gender, and political affiliation can also lead to disparate personal experiences and perspectives among community members. So for this observation, we will be hearing from Dr. Elizabeth Cartwright. Liz is a professor of anthropology at Idaho State University, and she is the co-PI for our Idaho team. Following Liz, we will hear from Dr. Stephanie McClure. Stephanie is an associate professor of anthropology at the University of Alabama, and she is the PI for the Alabama team. So Liz, over to you.
Thank you, Emily. Our team of university professors and students has worked with Hispanic community members in rural Idaho since 1999. Many things have changed over the last 20 years. Hispanic agricultural workers are now more diverse than ever. Our research shows that different generations have vastly different experiences, even in these small, somewhat remote towns out on the Snake River Plain. In these small rural communities, individuals know each other. They communicate easily. They have a shared sense of belonging. None of these things should be underestimated when it comes time to face difficulties, such as those that occurred during the pandemic. As we strive to create livable places for future generations, size matters and bigger is not necessarily better. We learned much about vaccination perceptions, next slide, from conducting 41 interviews and 3 focus groups. Younger people tend to have better access to scientific information. Older individuals rely heavily on the younger generation to share new ideas and alleviate fears. They also tend to rely more on information from back home in Mexico. Constant contact between Idaho and Mexico is facilitated by social media of all kinds. Information travels quickly back and forth across the borders. Among the males age 18 to 60, the need to work was a resounding reason for getting vaccinated. The vast majority of men in this category were working in agriculture. Several interviewees have come on temporary work visas from Mexico. All the men working on the large farms spoke about how their employers had gotten the vaccines for them and they had received the vaccines. The local clinics, pharmacies, and health department all have done vaccine clinics at the farms and warehouses. No one spoke about having difficulties in accessing a vaccine if they wanted one, and all but a couple interviewees wanted the vaccine. Next slide. While vaccines may be available, there's a lack of health insurance for many of the individuals working in agricultural jobs. The fear of getting sick and losing work is palpable in interview responses. The huge hospital bills that face families whose members were very sick with COVID early in the pandemic are a strong incentive for vaccination. Those individuals who knew someone who had been very sick or died of COVID-19 often stated that as a reason for wanting the vaccine. Our team has helped local healthcare professionals develop just-in-time interventions. Early this spring, we determined that undocumented workers were concerned about going to a government-sponsored public health office to get vaccinated. People were afraid that they would have to show proof that they were in the US legally. Our team worked with the local public health office to develop a flyer that expressly stated that no documentation of any kind would be required for a person to receive a vaccination through their office. An additional flyer was developed in Spanish that explained where one could get the COVID-19 vaccines. Members of the research team distributed the flyers to local farms and Latino grocery stores, where many members of the Hispanic community live and work. Our team members have improved local vaccine access, and they will carry understandings gained working on the CommuniVax project into their professional futures, helping to make our small corner of the world a better place. Thank you.
Our findings around non-homogeneity are very informative, but not surprising. As anthropologists, one of the things we know is that human groups are characterized by similarity and difference, and that both similarity and difference are important. This was certainly true in Alabama, and begins with COVID's effects in our target counties. We found similarity and difference at the county and individual levels in experiences of the virus and in experience intention and action around vaccination. Next slide. There are similarities and differences between Black majority and Black minority counties in Alabama. Vaccination rates are higher among Blacks than whites in rural Alabama counties. However, vaccination rates are below Black population proportion in our three Black majority counties. State level and grassroots access efforts and grassroots persuasion efforts explain the relative success in vaccinating older Black community members. But access and hesitancy continue to be barriers to progress towards population immunity. This brings us to the consideration of variability within communities. Next slide. Response to experience with the virus is not necessarily predictable on its face. The response that you see here from one of our participants fits the mainstream vaccination protects narrative. After her husband's week of severe illness, during which he lost 25 pounds, this woman and her husband were vaccinated as soon as they could be. Next slide. But the response depicted here does not fit the vaccination protects narratives. After the death of her mother from COVID, this participant wanted nothing to do with anything COVID related, including vaccination. Next slide. It's not always clear what did or will persuade people to be vaccinated, though we have gained some insight. Many cited efforts of those like the first participant who on this slide, who encouraged vaccination among her family members. And then there are those like the second participant who see the virus and the vaccine as equivalent risks. It is often not immediately clear how to shift that balance of fear. However, it is clear that movement from hesitancy to vaccination takes time. Next slide. If there is a common barrier to vaccination among our participants, it is distrust of medicine and the healthcare delivery system. Overcoming distrust takes time. So how do we move towards population immunity in the meantime? One participant framed her choice to be vaccinated as a combined response of experience, logical action, and faith. Her answer won't work for everyone, but it suggests a framework that we continue to seek combinations of experience, logical action, and trust that will persuade other community members to join the ranks of the vaccinated. Emily?
Great, thank you very much, Stephanie and Liz. So I'd like to turn to a few questions for the two of you. In listening to each other's presentations, and you dealt with different ethnic and racial communities, obviously in different areas of the country, but you both had rural areas in your sites. That was all Idaho and part of the Alabama research area. So thinking about this and listening to each other's presentations, what do you feel was the biggest similarity between your communities and what was the biggest difference?
One of the biggest similarities I saw was the importance of family to getting information about vaccination and also family considerations in the decision to be vaccinated. So in Alabama, younger family members often facilitated access to vaccine appointments in the early days because of problems with broadband access or skill level with the internet. So people really looked out for each other, and older people really took a role in persuading their other family members to be vaccinated in many cases. So family was really the first level of connection and persuasion for people to be vaccinated in our group.
Thank you, Stephanie. You know, I think that one of the things that really stood out to me is that in both of these rural communities, you know, we have these groups of majority and minority populations, and the vaccination rates are very different between the two oftentimes. And I think that one of the interesting things at this point now for both of our rural communities, a similarity, I think, would be that I think it would be an important time to reach out and to try to figure out what the majority people are thinking and how the interaction between groups in these areas are really giving people the information that they have and is pushing decision-making one way or the other.
And in terms of difference, I would say one of the biggest one is that in Idaho, you had this large group of farm workers who were already vaccinated and or who sought vaccination and in really large numbers. And this is a younger group of people, and that's the group of people that we're having difficulty getting vaccinated in Alabama. And I think Idaho is kind of pointing the way that work sites, as Noe mentioned, are going to be really critical to making vaccination easily accessible to people, and then tying that vaccination to work, I think, is going to be a key strategy.
I so agree, Stephanie. You know, the one thing that really stood out to me is we've been working in these communities for 20 years. I mean, we're working now with the sons and daughters of our first group of promotoras de salud that we started, you know, in 1999. And one of the things that we've seen over the years is that people work in the same places and they have really strong relationships between employers and employees. And so these long-term work relationships that people can rely on and trust in is, I think, a really strong building block for creating a good continued vaccine availability and acceptance.
Thank you. So considering the differences that exist among communities of color across the US, but also within these communities, that really make one size fits all solutions impossible. What can be done? How can local and state public health departments, for example, work more effectively with communities in their areas?
Well, again, I would say that we can take a lesson from Idaho and also from San Diego, and in terms of their use of community health workers. I think that's going to be key, particularly to public health promotion, successful public health promotion, particularly in rural Alabama, because what we've seen, you know, over and over again is a kind of disconnect from the sort of state architecture of public health delivery and what happens on the ground with people who live in more remote areas. So that community health worker model, I think, is going to be critical to changing the public health profile in Alabama.
You know, I think that the community health worker model is such a beautiful thing, and it's such a great first step. And, you know, we took it maybe 15 years ago. And I think we've really tried to now move on from that. And so our approach was to engage 20 of our young university students. Half of them were Hispanic first generation college students. to engage those as members of the research team. So they were community members going to college, and they were also part of the research team, because it's in that moment when the students learn that they can, and community members as they are, they learn that they can ask questions of the situation, they can gather data, they can take that data and have a great seat at the table with the, with our wonderful open public health department has allowed these students into the meetings, and to see the students just glow when they are, when they're asked their opinion. It's just great. And so seeing how these students supporting their education and moving forward, I think that that's really a critical step.
Excellent. Thank you both very much. So just as a reminder, we are going to get time for audience questions. And if you have those, please put those in the Q&A box, and we'll get to them in a moment. So we'll turn now to the third observation. Coming from the local research. So, and that is that hyper-local responses to the pandemic result in better health outcomes. Community-led, organized, and advocated members have closed COVID-19 gaps, response gaps. And Stephanie and Liz were just giving us examples of some of those that occurred locally in their areas. We've also seen examples of this in the national media. Such efforts are particularly powerful because the grassroots organizations leading these initiatives already have the trust of community members. They also understand the socioeconomic and cultural realities of their lives. This knowledge and understanding is critical, as is trust. In fact, we propose through our local research that COVID-19 vaccination is now moving at the speed of public trust. And that without trust, vaccination efforts, and especially COVID-19 vaccination efforts moving forward, are not capable of success. For this observation, we'll be hearing from Dr. Andrew Plunk. Andy is an associate professor of pediatrics at Eastern Virginia Medical School, and he is the PI for our Virginia team. Following Andy, we'll hear from Dr. Stephen Thomas. Stephen is a professor of health policy management and the director of the Maryland Center for Health Equity at the University of Maryland School of Public Health. Stephen is the co-PI for our Maryland Prince George's County team. So Andy, over to you.
Thank you very much. So here is Hampton Roads, where we are working. It's the southeasternmost region in Virginia. The area itself is a mix of rural and urban communities. Norfolk, the city in which most of the team is located, is more or less in the middle of that highlighted area there on the map. And in our study, we worked with area public housing communities. Next slide, please. We found that differences between rural and urban areas seemed to be very informative. It's worth noting that even while access was far more restricted in rural areas of Virginia, many of those regions achieved much higher than average vaccination rates. On the other hand, not a single participant from the Hampton Roads cities that we worked with reported that they had any barriers to getting a vaccine if they wanted one. And vaccination rates in some of the cities here, Norfolk, for example, are among the lowest in Virginia. However, I wouldn't call this vaccine hesitancy per se. Next slide, please. Instead, this really does seem to be related to a much more pervasive sense of mistrust, and not just of vaccines, but rather almost everything that's happening right now. And I think it's important to explain what this means. Trust seems to have real consequences for marginalized communities that most of us probably won't ever be able to fully understand. And in this way, trust could even be thought of as a survival strategy. Mistrust, rather, should be thought of as a survival strategy. So I'm talking about something that starts to represent a different way of looking at the world. This type of mistrust seems to be associated with assuming that you have fundamentally different goals and values. This isn't something that an educational campaign, for example, will fix. Instead, you address this by becoming more trustworthy. And I'm convinced that the only way you can do that is by building relationships. Next slide, please. I think our experiences get at some of what's really required to make this approach work. We realized early on in the pandemic that our engagement with our community advisory board would be quite disrupted. And we couldn't just naively transition to online meetings with them. Some of our CAB, for example, had never used computers before. So we had the responsibility for ensuring that we'd still be able to engage with our partners. In our case, that meant committing to not letting a lack of access to technology be a limiting factor. Everyone we work with gets a tablet, an unlimited data plan, and as much technical support as they need. So how has all this worked out? I think it's gone really well. As of yesterday, our team has had 166 Zoom meetings with folks who we've provided tablets to. So what I didn't anticipate at all was being able to build new relationships this way, especially not with communities who rightfully distrust outsiders. But we started the lockdown with 11 CAB members from Norfolk, and now we're meeting with over 30 lay community members from all across our region. And what have we been doing with the CAB? Well, they help interpret research findings, they guide grant proposals, and several members have been co-authors on recently submitted manuscripts. So what is the key takeaway from this? Well, I think you have to commit to doing everything you can to create lasting, respectful relationships. In our case, one of the things that we had to do was ensure that folks had a way to talk to us. The details of that got pretty involved with the technology and all that, but at the end of the day, it's still just a way to express a commitment to a relationship. And I think that people will respond to that if you do it sincerely.
Thank you. Nod your head, Emily, if you can hear me. Very good. I'm Stephen Thomas from the CommuniVax Rapid Response Team in Prince George's County. And I'm so excited to be here and bring you greetings from our team. What does hyperlocal really mean? And you know, for us, it was a recognition that Prince George's County has a population of almost 1 million people, and 65% of them self-identify as Black. Another 20% identify as Latino or some other non-white group. We recognize that even within this majority, minority population, there's heterogeneity. Next slide. In fact, Prince George's County is seen as one of the wealthiest majority Black counties in the United States. And yet there are pockets of poverty. And Prince George's County was one of the hotspots in the state of Maryland for COVID. What you see here is how we built upon the existing infrastructure at our Center for Health Equity, where our theme is building bridges, building trust, building healthy communities. And I just want to highlight one of those aspects, and that's the work that we've been doing in barbershops and beauty salons. Why not go where people already have trust? Barbershops and beauty salons can be places where conspiracy theories spread, or places where you can get accurate information about COVID and an opportunity for people to make informed decisions. So as you look at these images around this scene here, we had our barbers and stylists, including myself, once we got vaccinated, we made it public and we promoted that. Very important. The other image you see there are two of our barbers getting a saliva COVID test that we made possible for them. Now that's part of the conversation in the barbershops. And we brought in graphic artists to translate the information into a format more accessible to the community. Next slide. And so with that, look at what has happened. We conducted the first COVID vaccines in a barbershop and a beauty salon in the state of Maryland. And it was hugely successful, so successful that our efforts got picked up by the White House. And now this effort of bringing vaccines in barbershops and salons is occurring across the country. Here's how hyper-local can also be hyper-national. That image in the middle where you see the CNN coverage. So the story is local but national. Take home, misinformation is real. We need to address it. Number two, meet people where they are. No shame, no blame. And number three, trust really matters. It's not just the message, but also the messenger. And with that, I'll stop.
I'm off mute. Thank you, Stephen and Andy. And I think the point that you're ending on, Stephen, that misinformation is pervasive, and it definitely is. But one of the things that we're finding from our local research, including the research from Prince George's County and Virginia, is that trust matters. And that's a key way to overcome misinformation. So both of you described building trust with community members in your local areas, and you both of your teams have been very successful at doing so. So I'd like you to consider, how can this happen elsewhere? What steps can a mayor or a county public health official take to demonstrate to local communities of color that they and the COVID-19 response and the vaccination campaign are trustworthy?
Let us know who you're throwing the ball to.
You and Andy.
One of the things that we've figured out is that this Zoom Hollywood Squares has eventually brought us all together in ways that were unimaginable. Oh, I got a mayor on with a barber and a physician. And one of the leaders like Anthony Fauci and the other national leaders, to bring them all together in one room in a virtual space has been amazing. And it shows respect for the common folk, for the people from the common walk of life. And when they have that interaction, I think they come away feeling that they do matter. And that's the beginning of establishing a relationship.
And I do think that the relationships are important, and expressing a commitment to those relationships as well, making sure that you're going to give folks who might not have the ability, the capacity to do that without some help, give them the ability to do that, be able to connect with you, be able to talk to you. I do think that when that's done sincerely, like Stephen mentioned, this Hollywood Squares kind of Zoom environment, we have folks who, like I mentioned, never used computers before. But they, I know that they set an alarm every week before our meeting so that they'll make sure that they attend because they enjoy it so much. And I think that that just wouldn't be the case if we hadn't made, if they didn't see that we had made a sincere commitment to them to want to do that, to want to be there with them, to experience that with them, to get their feedback. And I think that anybody can do that. Local mayors can do that as long as they are actually sincere about making those first steps and reaching out to folks and meeting them where they're at.
And that sincerity means that once you start the relationship, you don't just abandon them. And they've asked us this question because they're seeing the health professionals and hospital systems come in fairly aggressively. And they're saying, Dr. T, who's this for? For them or for us? I'm saying, what do you mean? If they just give us the jab and leave us with diabetes and heart disease and obesity, then it's very clear it's for them. We can shop, we can do things and spend money and not spread virus. I think that if we don't figure out a way of addressing those underlying conditions that made COVID so bad with this new infrastructure that we have, we would be missing an opportunity. I have health systems now that now have trustworthiness because they've come on our heels into these shops, and they've made a commitment in public that we will stay to address the diabetes and the hypertension. And guess what? Flu season's right around the corner. How can we use this infrastructure to get ready for the next wave?
Yeah, that's super important. And being responsive to what community needs are, listening to them, making sure that you're going to be there, not just to get their feedback and maybe not do anything with it. Bring your success and your results back to them, report back to them, make them involved in the whole process. I think those are all very positive steps that I do think that anybody, if we actually do commit to that, can do at any level.
And Andy, when we talk about measuring success, sometimes the reporters ask, how many arms did you get a vaccine in? And I have to explain to them, we're at the hell no wall. We're at the wall where people are saying hell no for no reason. And so it's really the stories that are more important. It's that grandmother who brought her grandkids in to get vaccinated. It's the families who come. And I think that's what Communivax is able to do with our hyperlocal approach, to literally bring the stories of the people to the table. And at this phase in our effort around hesitancy, which does not mean never, it means taking the time and treating people with dignity and respect. We had a gentleman who came in hesitant. And guess what? He left hesitant, but he got vaccinated. You don't have to change your worldview. But he was treated in a way where he felt that he was respected. At this point, that's vitally important. It also is helping our health systems rebuild their relationship with a community that has been neglected simply based on the epidemiology of these preventable diseases. And I think that they're recognizing, you know what? You got to make your friends before you need them. And this has given them an opportunity to be visible and present in the community in ways that they're having an aha moment that they need to be here on a routine basis.
Thank you both for your comments. So at this point, we're going to turn to questions from our audience. Once again, please, if you have any questions, put them in the Q&A box. And I'd like to turn this over to Monica, who will ask the questions that have been submitted so far.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for attending, and thank you for loading up our Q&A box with good questions. Our very first question comes from Ronnie Robin of the New York Times. And that concerns issues surrounding low vaccination rates in the Black community. For our researchers who have worked among local Black communities, are there additional insights and nuances that you can share with our audience today about the low vaccination rates in the communities that you have worked with?
Well, let me just begin by saying, at the very beginning of this pandemic, our communities, our Black and brown communities, were marinating in misinformation. And it's not a criticism of our health departments simply being stretched to a point where they could not counter those things in real time. And so by the time Communivax comes on board and begins building that infrastructure, those communities were sitting with that misinformation for months. And a lot of it was coming from the White House in the previous administration. If we don't acknowledge that, then we don't realize the impact that that has had. You don't overcome that in 7 months. You don't overcome that in 7 months. And so I think that we simply need to make the commitment for long-term engagement. Long-term engagement, no shame, no blame. It means you actually have to listen. And so the low vaccination rates are complex, but we're seeing the needle move and we need to give it time and even be more aggressive in letting people know what this Delta variant really means. Now, be mindful, the counter messaging out there has money and they have literally produced movies trying to tell Black people not to be vaccinated. We have headwinds, but we also have a strategy to move forward.
I'd just like to second what Dr. Thomas had to say. He's absolutely right about the pervasiveness of the of misinformation and how long it takes to overcome that. And also to point out that I think everyone has said that number one, hesitancy is multifaceted and that overcoming hesitancy takes time. I'd also like to point out that the projected resistance has actually lower than was actually higher than the resistance that we've met. In other words, there were African Americans from the beginning who were eager to get the virus. And in the early days, the problem was access. And so we say, at least on the Alabama team, we say fight access with hesitancy, which goes back to the point that Dr. Thomas was making. Let's stay present. You know, let's meet people where they are. Let's work locally. And particularly in Alabama, what I talked about in our data, the vaccination rates among rural whites are actually lower than the vaccination rates among rural Blacks. So let's then talk about how access is being done in those rural areas so that people have the opportunity to say yes.
And you know, Stephanie, because the question came from a New York Times reporter, in the paper, consistently, when they say hesitancy, they say, oh, the reason is the Tuskegee syphilis study. And I want that reporter to know this, that in Macon County, rural Alabama, Stephanie, they are getting vaccinated. The sons and daughters of the Tuskegee syphilis study participants have been vaccinated, and they've been gone on camera to say, do not use the legacy and the suffering of our ancestors as the reason for not being vaccinated. And so that story needs to be lifted up even more. The real contextualization of Tuskegee is that those men were denied treatment. What we need to do now is make sure every effort is made to ensure that African Americans receive access to this vaccine in trusted settings. And so Stephanie, you are absolutely right. We have moved the needle there. And we need that story to be told more broadly and for our stories not to be behind a paywall. If trash and misinformation flows freely, we can't have the good information behind a paywall. So how do we handle that with the new business models of our newspapers?
Indeed. And one more thing before we move on to the next question, I also want to emphasize, and the sons and daughters of the Tuskegee participants are making this point as well. Our African American, and everyone on this panel who's talked about the African American community has also made this point. African Americans' distrust and hesitancy is not merely historical. It is rooted in the poor relationships that Andy and that Dr. Thomas talked about. It's rooted in a long and ongoing incidents of unequal treatment in the healthcare delivery system. And Tuskegee serves as a metonym because it's a big event, right? But it captures, it encapsulates, it stands for all of those instances of being turned away or treated less well or ignored or having racist assumptions inform things like the administration of pain medication. You can't wish that away and dismissing it as an historically rooted mistrust belies the present day reality of the structural barriers to healthcare access that exists for African Americans in this country.
Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you, Dr. Thomas, for those additional comments. Because the question opened up the issue of misinformation, we're going to introduce the question from Madeline Pannell. We've seen that the impact of misinformation on decision-making is particularly difficult to address, especially when it comes to overcoming medical mistrust to get the vaccine. So I would invite our researchers, both who have worked in local Black and local Hispanic and Latino communities, can you please share successful strategies for addressing that? What are the tools, the tasks, the interventions that can be used to diffuse and defang misinformation?
I can start to speak to that, Monica. What we've seen in our city, there's one, in terms of combating misinformation, there's one channel, Facebook channel that provides news. It's a local reporter named Pedro Palomino. Everyone knows him, everyone watches his channel. And one of the things that happened early on is that folks working in the COVID response started working with Pedro and started doing shows on his channel, trying to combat misinformation, talking about, initially it was about protective measures, then it was about testing, it's eventually become about vaccines. And so having a clear understanding about who the messengers are, who your local population really listens to, watches, has been a good strategy here. The other thing that that struck us as the pandemic has sort of persevered has been the role of WhatsApp groups. And that's very common in our immigrant communities because that's how they're communicating with folks back in their countries of origin. And and information just whips around WhatsApp groups so quickly and unabated, and it can become a little bit of an echo chamber for folks. So one of the things that we've been trying to do is make sure that there are community outreach workers, our health workers are able to join those groups and do their best to be able to combat the misinformation as much as possible as it comes around. I mean, we hear folks saying, look, I saw this video of this woman in a doctor's coat from, you know, El Salvador or Guatemala, wherever folks are from, and saying, and she's saying all these things and she looks very serious and very professional. And so that takes a concerted, persistent effort to combat what ends up coming across as quite authoritative, but in fact is spreading terrible misinformation in these communities. And so those are some strategies that have been tried here, both using our local media partners that are connecting to these communities, as well as, I don't want to use the word infiltrating, but joining these groups, these which are sharing the misinformation.
Daniela, we have a request for you to put the link to the Facebook channel.
Sure.
Would you mind putting that in the Q&A or chat, whichever works?
I'll do that as soon as we finish the Q&A session, just so I can be paying attention to
sure.
the conversation.
Got it.
And Monica, what we've done are doing these web Zoom town halls and bringing the community voices to the table and not in the form of a lecture, but in the form of a conversation. And they love that. And then it was so successful in the Black community, our Latinx friends said, can you do one in all Spanish? And we did one in all Spanish with English translations. And you could tell that just the passion with which they spoke and they told their stories really came through when they could speak in their own language. And so that request keeps coming. Again, people are now getting comfortable with this format, this Zoom town hall format. I think it's a way for us to counter some of the misinformation.
And I just add, I think, again, this idea where we need to really worry and be thoughtful about how we're being perceived, if we are being perceived as trustful, if we are being perceived as trustworthy, and doing what we can to maintain relationships with the communities with whom we're interacting, so that we don't just, you know, we're not being seen as just maintaining the status quo. If we can kind of flip that on its head, meet people where they're at, again, be sincere when we do that. I think that we can, you know, it's not just education at this point, it's who do they trust, right? And they're going to trust people who they have relationships with.
Yes,
thanks, thanks, Andy. In the interest of moving through some of our questions, I want to pull in Jesse Nodora's question. There are many national equity-focused research projects, and that includes the RADx UP initiative from sponsored by the National Institutes of Health. So what is happening, researchers in your communities, in your areas, to coordinate your efforts with these other ones that are going on? And how do you think the results from the research is going to be useful to the communities with whom you and the others out there are working?
Maybe I can briefly touch on that. Here in San Diego, we are now also integrating strategies to understand vaccination uptake within the RADx Up infrastructure. And so we are now planning to include strategies and activities within those sites, the RADx Up sites, to now increase vaccination uptake among those communities. So that is happening locally.
And I can say that here in Baltimore City, I mean, the universe of folks that are working with this community and immigrants in general is quite small. So a lot of us already know each other. We're actually familiar with we actually work with some of the members on the RADx team that's working with Latinos here in Baltimore City. But the other thing that's happened is that there's a couple of city agencies that have come together to form specific subcommittees that are focused on immigration, outreach to immigrants. And so those end up being a forum. We meet every couple of weeks. Those end up being a forum for sharing what folks are doing, what kind of strategies are being planned, and trying to address, and being cognizant of the fact that some access issues are common across our immigrant groups here in the city, but some are not. And so thinking about ways of addressing them in ways that are responsive to each community's needs.
Thank you, Danielle. And thank you for those wonderful answers and questions. I'm going to turn this back to Emily, who's going to close out this portion of the discussion.
Thank you, Monica. As all of our audience members have now experienced, the local teams have been conducting research, and the results that have come out of their work, I think, exemplify the complexity of this issue. We're not dealing with a simple issue, and because of that, there aren't simple solutions. There are no silver bullets with this. But we are going to get to some recommendations that the working group primarily was able to take based on these local observations. And that will take us to the second half of our webinar. That session will be moderated by Monica. And so I'll turn it over to you, just saying once again, thank you very, very much to all of our local team panelists.
Thank you, Emily. It's my pleasure to introduce the work of the working group that was informed by the local researchers. I'm going to call out the five recommendations that were included within our report. And the first is humanized delivery and communication strategies for COVID-19 vaccines. And we have very concrete examples of that. Next slide. From our local teams. The second is about embedding vaccination within a larger holistic recovery process. And those two recommendations are what the working group considers urgent, that these need to be taken immediately and that they can enhance vaccination coverage in underserved populations moving forward. The second set of recommendations were what we call essential, that these are ones that can steadily drive systems level changes that advance health equity in an ongoing way. And the first is to develop a national immunization program to protect people throughout the life course. Second of our essential recommendations is rebuilding the public health infrastructure and properly staffing it for community engagement. And then lastly, stabilizing the community health system as the backbone for equity and resilience. If you could go back to the prior slide, I do want to introduce our panelists. They are members of the Working Group on Equity and COVID-19 Vaccination. Before you, you will see the list of all the working group members. They include community advocates, social scientists, public health experts, and leading vaccinologists. And today we're going to hear from, and prior to, we can close out the slides, thank you. We're going to hear from Ms. Arietta Chakos, who is a principal at Urban Resilience Strategies. And I'm going to introduce all of our panelists at once because we're going to have a moderated discussion among them. Our second participant is Dr. Walter Orenstein, and Walt is a professor of medicine, pediatrics, global health and epidemiology at Emory University. Dr. Richard Krieg, who is a visiting professor of political science at Texas State University and also an editor of the Journal of Critical Infrastructure Policy. And we also have with us today Ms. Tanae Hamilton Franklin, who is the Vice President of Health Equity and Stakeholder Engagement at Health Leads. So it's a wonderful pleasure to have these colleagues here with us today. The format for today is I'm going to present each of the five recommendations in turn, and then ask our panelists to comment on recommendations, particularly those who have expertise and operational experience in dealing with the content. So let's first kick off with recommendation number one, and Arietta Chakos will be joining me. So just to reiterate, the first of our urgent recommendations is humanizing delivery and communication strategies for COVID-19 vaccines. Basically, that campaign should support more peer-led and neighborhood-based opportunities for community conversation and convenient vaccine access, just like the barbershops and hair salons in Prince George's County, for example. And we heard from multiple local sites that this human touch really does matter in terms of the success within the hell no wall days of the vaccination campaign, as Dr. Thomas put it. So Tanae, our first question is to you. You're one of the nation's leading voices on health equity, stakeholder engagement, and intercultural competence. Can you comment on how the community health workforce in particular can best be engaged in activities to reverse the current vaccination slowdown and also reverse the persistent unevenness in the vaccine coverage that we're seeing? Tanae.
I'll start by saying a lot of my comments are going to be similar to those that we had in the first and that of the discussion in the first hour. And that just means that to me that it's really, really important that we take notes and we get this right moving forward. As a country, we've made incredible efforts to engage communities throughout the country during the pandemic. But imagine for a moment how effective our strategies would have been if we had community health workers and a community-based workforce infrastructure in place before the pandemic. Imagine if community health workers were a robust part of our public health and healthcare infrastructure already. If that were the case, I wonder what our local responses could and would have been more efficient and seamless, particularly when it comes to messaging and vaccination turnout. It's not uncommon for us to turn to the community when it comes to executing health interventions. Public health, academia, and local governments routinely do this. We decide on an effective intervention, and then we turn to the community and say, okay, now we need your help to execute this particular strategy. We turn to community health workers and the community-based workforce because, again, these are trusted members of the community. It's possible to engage, but we should be engaging them at the beginning of the onset of the development of the strategy. And it's possible for us to do that. But a lot of times I think when we're faced with an emergency situation, we do our best to scramble and say, okay, now we need your help. But again, imagine if we had taken time up front to build out that infrastructure with community health workers. I think, and I'm from where I sit also in my other role that I have as the Board of Health member of my local health department, I think that our rollout with vaccination, education, messaging, and turnout could have been a little bit more efficient. Lastly, what I'll say is that growing up, my mom always told me, it's funny how you never have time to do it right in the first place, but when you do it wrong, you always have time to do it over. This is how I think about CHWs. Now that we are in a lull, I think it's an opportunity for us to take a step back and engage our community health workers and community-based workforce at the table to develop that next strategy. It's not too late. And so that is what I would encourage our local communities to do, is pull our CHWs in for development of a vaccine strategy in response to the pandemic.
Thank you, Tanae. Much appreciate those comments. Walt, if you could also comment on this first of two urgent recommendations, the need to humanize delivery and communication strategies for COVID-19 vaccines. Walt, you were one of the designers of the highly successful U.S. Childhood Immunization Program. So could you please comment on why you see public health's partnership with community groups and also the community health workforce that Tanae was just discussing as a critical move for improving vaccine coverage and for COVID-19, but then also leaving a legacy of greater public trust in immunizations overall.
Thank you very much, Monica. I will be also emphasizing a number of the points that were made, which is good in the sense that we're in a lot of agreement here. With regard to the immunization program, the first issue is you need to make the right diagnosis in order to design the right therapy. And each community may have different problems. For example, on the childhood side, in some places, the problem was clearly financial barriers to access. And that led to the development of something called the Vaccines for Children program, which removed vaccine cost as a barrier for eligible children, which are about 40 to 50% of the population. Other problems dealt with hesitancy. And then for that, to support research into determining who is trusted and who is not trusted and working with them. On the childhood side, it turned out the primary care provider was one of the major people trusted, and we worked very carefully with them. The other thing that was very important is we had substantial political support. A colleague of mine who trained at Hopkins said he was taught that P in public health is politics. You need to have that. And we got a presidential initiative supported by the Children's Defense Fund, where we were able to give substantial grants to states and localities. And one of the requirements of that grant is they had to develop coalitions and reach out to community-based organizations to work on reaching out and determining what is the problem and how can we best address the problem. And then finally, we had a good accountability system. We had good measurements. And people who were interested used that. For example, the first measurement, the National Immunization Survey, occurred in 1994. State of Michigan came out at the bottom. The person in charge of immunization in Michigan used that to get funding from his state legislature. And then he used that to build these relationships and community relationships and enhance Michigan's uptake. Having that kind of data would be very, very important.
Thank you so much, Walt. Thank you, Tanae. We're going to now shift to the second of two urgent recommendations, and that is to anchor COVID-19 vaccination for hard-hit areas in a holistic recovery process. Essentially, this recommendation has two components, and the first is that public agencies, hospitals, and health systems, nonprofit social service providers, community-based groups, faith-based organizations, and also community health workers should all align around a whole person model of recovery and then multiply the benefits of each vaccination encounter. And then the second part of the recommendation has a longer tail, and that is that state and local jurisdictions should now stand up a long-term recovery and community resilience organization, applying a health in all policies approach, and also pulling in data-driven coordinating bodies that already facilitate long-range planning, comprehensive planning, disaster recovery, economic development. I'm going to ask Arietta to join us and reflect on this recommendation. Arietta, drawing on your former career in local government and your ongoing work on community resilience to 21st century disasters, what advice would you give decision makers who may be thinking about COVID-19 vaccination in terms of restarting the economy and getting back to normal? How should they be thinking about recovery from the pandemic, especially for constituents who have been hit the hardest? Over to you, Arietta.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Tanae and Walt for the wonderful comments they made. I deeply appreciate Tanae's comments about wishing we'd had that CHW structure in place when things hit. And I'm also going to take Walt's colleague's quote, the P in public health is politics. And I agree with that. And so really we have not so much a technical problem before us, but we have people problems and challenges. So I want to give you a quote from one of our colleagues in the San Francisco Mission District, is shared by one of our working group colleagues, Isabel Duran. And this leader said, we can't return to normal. That is what got us here in the first place. So the first thing I would like to recommend to local communities, and especially the sort of foot-dragging bureaucrats, is that number one, we need to have shared and equalized local decision-making. And we have to acknowledge and act on the power disparity in our communities and follow our local residents and their community groups as leaders for elected representatives as we move into an equity and recovery movement. I think also we should think about making this moment, turning it into a movement as the CommuniVax Coalition has talked about, so that we can start to build the proper productive health equity and health in all policies efforts into our daily lives. We can, I think, leverage our vaccination efforts as gateway activities to a longer recovery implementation for communities writ large. We won't have to start at point zero. We have a lot to build on. And the guidance that our local teams and our community partners have shared with us really give us a ready-made blueprint for the work ahead. So I would recommend that we anchor all new equity programs as parts of our general and comprehensive community plans, that we build those out along with economic disaster mitigation and climate action requirements that all local communities have to work on. And I think once we have woven these health and all policies efforts into our daily lives in neighborhood plans, school safety plans, our clean water programs, our housing plans, we're going to have something that will really endure over time in the life of a local jurisdiction. We've had a lot of success using this immersive technique with respect to natural disaster readiness and resilience, which has been the field that I've worked in local government and regional government. And we've seen that protective acts taken ahead of time to safeguard community readiness will save lives, can reduce people's suffering, but for the skeptics, we're going to save some money as well. We can make a hard-nosed business decision, as we've learned from our public health colleagues, that preventative actions ahead of time can increase our resilience when the next disruption strikes. And I think that it's both a good humanitarian investment and it makes good business sense. The coalition at CommuniVax headquarters has learned a lot from our community partners and our local residents. And we're calling attention to ways government can rebalance power sharing with communities of color and really look at how we can co-produce health equity actions and ensure that equitable decisions are adopted together with people in our communities in the lead to build for an equality for all future ahead. And I think right now in our country, we literally have a funded mandate for health and community equity. And together we can use this possibility and make great progress in the disparities that we faced the last 400 years.
Thank you very much, Arietta. To sort of build on that, let's imagine you're the mayor of Hometown USA. I mean, what capital, human capital, financial capital, or stakeholders would you be pulling together right now to plan for long-term recovery from the pandemic? And given everything else you have to do as mayor, how would this activity rate?
Well, I would say, number one, as mayor of Hometown USA, I hope you've all voted for me and contributed to my campaign. And together we're gonna work on moving forward in the coming years. And number one, I think we have to look at how do we harvest funding from the American Rescue Plan, the CARES Act, and the other unprecedented flow of federal resources that have come into our local communities and use that to good purpose as we move forward on planning a long-term equitable recovery for everybody in our community. And I think that the second national report gives government and public health leaders a set of actionable recommendations developed by community leaders and community members. And we should, you know, put that to good use. So what I would do three things as we launch into this long-term recovery planning. Number one, I would look at how I convene and resource a health equity council in my community and have the city government and local elected and appointed officials serve as the staff to that council. And it would be composed of people from our communities all in all sectors in hometown. And what I'd like to say is that we will compensate our Health Equity Council members and value the time and leadership that they're bringing to crafting a future plan for where our community will go in the coming 3 to 5 years. Number two, I would appoint an equity advisor in my office to help coordinate again and bring resources to that equity council and to work on all things pandemic recovery related. And I think together with our community leaders, with other government partners, along with our media, we'll assess the implication of the health and community recovery data that we're getting and share our findings and actions from that health equity council in a very participatory decision-making context. And then third, I would galvanize my neighboring mayors and city managers in the region to join a regional recovery alliance so we can build on what the municipalities are doing together. You know, the recovery doesn't stop at our city borders. So we have to really look at broadening our look into the future and figuring out how we can use this literally once in a generation opportunity to jumpstart equity action and improve our public health and our community health systems writ large. And I think that local governments really have to take that evolutionary leap into allowing communities to lead the way.
Great. Thank you so much, Arietta. You've outlined very concrete, specific things that decision makers at the local level can do starting today. Walt, I'd like to return to you particularly to address recommendation number three, which is to develop a national immunization program to protect people throughout the life course. We have the COVID-19 vaccination moment to build out systems to provide broader coverage for not only COVID, but the 13 other vaccines that are urged for some or all adults. We do know, Walt, that immunization rates for racial and ethnic minority adults are far below those of white adults. So if we apply hyperlocal strategies like the report recommends to improve broad coverage of COVID-19, how can hyperlocal strategies be folded into and help build out this national immunization program that could help people throughout the life course?
Thank you very much, Monica. I think that's a very important question. First thing we need to realize is most of the vaccine preventable diseases are what's known as person-to-person spread diseases. And if we have pockets in our population of poor vaccination status, then those populations serve as potential reservoirs to infect populations everywhere, so that it is in our universal interest to get immunization rates against the vaccine preventable diseases of adults up in every single population. And so I think it's a win-win situation for all populations. Two, as I think it's very important to try and work with people to try and overcome the problem and build an infrastructure that can be helpful not only for routine vaccination, but in dealing with emergencies like COVID-19. We have a great infrastructure in childhood vaccination. We closed the gaps in immunization in childhood, and we have, for the most part, for most vaccines, about 90%. And if there are gaps, they're usually just a few percentage points in differences. And that's because we have substantial funding that was given to state and local health departments to work with communities and get immunization coverage up. We need to do that for adults. We do a lousy job for adults. For example, for influenza, in the last data I saw on the CDC website for 2017-2018 is in the white population, 49%. In the Black population, 39%, and Hispanic, 37.5%. And that's terrible. I think we need to do a lot better in order to reduce transmission and reduce the stress on our healthcare system and our employment system because of people potentially getting sick. And I think the goal, I think, by raising this is to have an infrastructure that can be pulled into emergencies instead of having created.
Thanks, Walt. You really sketch out a really critical public health and societal goal. We're still in the middle of a pandemic. So is this now really the time to be talking about building out the national immunization program for protecting people throughout the full life course? Why is now a good time for us to be talking about this and doing things about it?
I think the potential here is because we can get attention now. People realize we did not have the infrastructure available to deliver COVID-19 vaccines in a fashion we would have liked to. If we had an adult immunization program that was in good shape, we could draw on that infrastructure and, in my opinion, done a much better job in getting vaccines out to the people who need them with regard to COVID-19. This is the right time because I think we're likely to have the best political will to get in and for people to understand and move forward with funding efforts to enhance our adult immunization program. For measles, we found that the outbreaks of measles were very, very helpful in getting that political will. And it got us two presidential initiatives, funding, very, very substantial funding. And I think now we have this big concern that we're not vaccinating enough people. And we need to develop a program where people can be reached, where there's, for example, immunization registries, where you can get to people and explain things and offer them information and overcome some of the hesitancy and also overcome some of the access barriers. And so this is the perfect time to begin thinking about this. We think of vertical programs and horizontal programs. Vertical would be COVID and just COVID. Horizontally is using COVID to pull along the overall program, which will have substantial benefits well beyond the end of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Thanks very much, Walt. Your comments dovetail very nicely with recommendation number 4, which is to rebuild the public health infrastructure, properly staffing it for community engagement. And the 3 specific actions of this are leveling out boom and bust funding, mirroring the communities being served, and strengthening human-centric competencies. I'm going to ask Rich Krieg to join us. Rich, you once ran a metropolitan health department in a city that is Chicago, where today 150 plus languages are spoken. Why is it so critical that public health agencies commit to the strategic goal of promoting equity in their ranks at every level, including the department and including their Department of Health? Rich, please join me.
Rich, you're on mute.
There we go. Can you hear me? Okay.
Sorry. Loud and clear.
Okay. I want to just start, Walter just mentioned the measles situation and how it helped to propel more funding for health departments. And you mentioned 150 languages. And back in Chicago, we had a measles epidemic where we had a couple of kids die of encephalitis. It was a bad scene. All the major cities were experiencing this. And the vector for that virus was Latino daycare centers that were not certified in terms of requiring vaccinations. And we learned back there Spanish has subdivisions in terms of the Puerto Rican community and the Mexican American community living in Chicago. So I say that to illustrate that you cannot discharge the public health function unless you have connections to the community and the ability to relate to communities. You know, this issue is a push-pull, really. The health departments cannot do what they have to do unless they have the involvement of communities. And that really is the focus of the major public health organizations in the public health field. Going back two decades, the first report that was written on the future of public health was the Institute of Medicine, which said basically that health departments have to have an organic connection to communities in order to do the mainstream public health departments and anything else that falls within their responsibilities by way of new events that happen. In addition, as that's evolved, the current state of the art, and this is taught in schools of public health, and it also is the position of most health departments, and that is that the health leaders at the state and local level really need to be chief health strategists. You have to have an ability to register what the problems are in the community, to study those problems, and to take whatever strategy makes the most sense to solve those problems and to have the capacity to continue working those problems. So that in many of the plans that occur, you cannot do it unless there are community members involved, unless you have a health department that reflects the community within its ranks, and unless you have the broad vision of looking towards health equity as the ultimate outcome of what that health department does. That is the state of the art of the field. That's where health departments need to go. And I think that perspective is very important to the community also. Among the 2,800 local health departments, for example, we have the full range of awareness of community involvement and the need to have a health department that interacts very closely with the community in terms of all of the work that it does. So in places where you have a lack of health involvement with the community, there has to be an awareness by the community that health department needs to up its game and move in the direction that the field is going. And that's a tough thing to do. But that perceptual understanding that modern public health cannot occur without solid linkages with the community, and in many cases, leadership by the community, will not allow you to register what's happening. So I think that we have to look towards departments that are doing this. Nicole Alexander Scott in Rhode Island has set up over the years, the department set up health equity zones that really are formulated on this basis. How do we achieve health equity in terms of the populations that fall under the jurisdiction of that health department? And there are other health departments at the state level also that have very good models. One size does not fit all. And, we heard in the first group of presentations from the community that there are community health workers, also that you can enlist various categories of people to get involved. College students were mentioned. I sit on the National Advisory Committee of the Association of Returned Peace Corps Volunteers. And when we pull back those volunteers from other countries based on COVID-19, everybody who was out in the world came back to the States. We worked to get people of color primarily, but others as well, involved in vaccination campaigns. So resourceful thinking about how it is that you get people on the ground and working with the health department are essential. The last thing I want to say is that schools of public health really are should be a focal point. In the barbershop interactions that we heard about before, I'd love to hear a barber say to a young African-American or Latino youth, ever think of being the head of your of the health department? Here's a job path that's pretty exciting. And I think that schools of public health are really wanting to bring in people who reflect communities around the country and have very good programs to arm them with public health science. So I think it has to be a multi-factor approach. And the last thing I would say, following what Arietta mentioned just now, we have to turn this moment into a movement. And the movement should not just be to increase the capabilities of health departments, but also towards health equity and the appropriate public health and healthcare roles that have to follow on that mission.
Thanks so much, Rich. That was very, very helpful. I'm going to combine your conversation with the closeout of our fifth recommendation, which I'm going to direct to Tanae. But again, these are systems level investments. And I love the connection, Rich, you made about engaging students, engaging community health workers and sort of thinking ahead to leadership roles within the health department. So we know, sadly, that there have been racial disparities in rates of COVID-19 infection and deaths. And we have a renewed awareness about glaring health inequities in the US, but we also have a renewed awareness of the labor force uniquely suited to help repair both of those things. And Tanae kicked us off originally with a focus on the community health workforce. So the fifth recommendation is about stabilizing the community health system as the backbone for equity and resilience. And Rich, you know that public health has a very strong and lasting relationship with the community health workforce. So this recommendation is about formalizing and sustainably financing the community health workforce and granting funds to community-based and faith-based organizations directly. And so, Tanae, I would like you to talk a little bit more about what bearing the strength of the community health system has on the overall well-being of low-income communities of color. I mean, what is it that sets apart the community health workforce and the services they provide? I mean, how do they stand apart from other portions of the larger health sector? Over to you, Tanae.
I do agree with what Rich so eloquently laid out about the systemic barriers that are in place and the systemic opportunities to overcome those barriers. I think that's important. But let me just center before I dive deep into my comments, let me just center us for a moment. We're talking about racial disparities with rates of COVID, but particularly in the Black community and the Latinx community, we know that these rates of racial disparities amongst all public health and health outcomes have existed for years. And that was clear in the 1985 Heckler report commissioned by Margaret Heckler, who was then head of health and human services for the federal government. So this is not anything new, but what the pandemic has done is it has given us an opportunity to change those systems once and for all to get it right. When you think about community health workers, I just want to offer another perspective, particularly from the faith-based perspective. In the Black church, for instance, when you think about individuals in the church that are the ones that are most likely to lean in with health interventions, that could be nursing ministries. So that's not uncommon across different denominations, and particularly with the Black church, particularly in the South. And so those individuals are the same individuals that, one, have trusted relationships in the community. They have somewhat of a health education background or they are a nursing background. And they're able to they're proximate and they're able to help execute and help lean in with strategies to help with regards to different health interventions. And so that's the type of workforce that we're thinking about. So the health system has an opportunity to once and for all validate that expertise and that lived experience as a commodity that's helpful for healthcare. And until we do that, it's going to be, we're going to sort of stop and start all over again. And so if we really want to change the systems, if we really want to address the inequities, we're going to have to invest in that particular workforce with community health workers, with others that have that level of expertise, approximation to the community, and that have that have the trust. I will say this in closing for this statement, access to health interventions cannot always be done in the clinic. We've seen this with the pandemic in terms of taking the vaccination efforts to the communities. I first learned of CHWs or community health workers as part of the medical home to make sure that patients and families had everything that they needed that the physicians and nurses couldn't provide. So community health workers as part of the public health workforce, community health workers are integrated into the community and they also build on their individual and community capacity by increasing health knowledge and self-sufficiency through a range of activities. I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Tanae. I think to close out comments by our working group members on the five recommendations, I want to invite all four of you to consider this scenario. The four of you have been tapped to advise, let's say county leadership or state leadership on how to achieve greater vaccine coverage in underserved populations. The problem before you is how do you encourage these decision makers who may be thinking in terms of, you know, getting vaccines, getting people to roll up their sleeves and get vaccinated? How do you encourage them to plan for the long game? Because all four of you have been talking about systems level changes that take investment of human and financial capital and political will. So what arguments would you use in advising county or state leadership to take the long game perspective? You know, what evidence would you deploy? What steps would you recommend first? You know, what would you tell them to set aside in their budgets, not only in the coming fiscal year, but for ongoing investments? And I'll just open the floor for any of you to kick off.
I'll jump in and I'll make it quick. And so we've talked about how we need investment in our communities and with regards to disparities in communities of color, community health workers, that is a strategy. And in order for to do that, community health workers have to be compensated with a living wage. It's not enough just to write them into a grant temporarily. There has to be career development for community health workers. And then lastly, there also needs to be an evaluation component on the effectiveness of community health workers. Those are the three things that I would start the conversation off with our mayor or elected officials in terms of a long-term strategy to help mitigate not only vaccination disparities with regards to COVID and other vaccinations, but also with regards to addressing the inequities that we have in our communities.
That was my, the very same thought was the budgeting process, because lots of local health departments were decimated from having had lower budgets. I know in the county health department around Toledo, Ohio, for example, they had one worker who was an environmental health worker who was in charge of rodent control and pools and so on. And she and two staff were the people that were doing disease prevention who were called in to start working on the vaccine program. And they all got COVID-19. It was a mess. So I think it's a moment when local health department directors, and I think this applies to the state level as well, have people's attention and need to build into their budget an ability to bounce off this pandemic and have the requisite staff. The first place to look is where they go for their budget every year. But beyond that, they have to put aside the time to understand that this is the moment that perhaps the field can get off its roller coaster, boom or bust funding type of thing. When Zika came in and H1N1 came in, budgets went up, then they went down. And just think, you know, when a local health department director, if there's a emergency at the local level, that health department director becomes the incident commander of all of the other parts of the local government. And imagine if the fire or police chief, imagine the fire department had no fires one year and they cut the budget 30% because of that. And that's what's happened in public health. So I think there's a long-term advocacy for more budget to make very good cases for that. And I think now's the time to do it. And secondly, to say the time put aside to work within associations and other networks that health directors have to advocate for more funding and to put that in to people who can work the community, work in the community, work in the department on behalf of the community. That's where those funds should go.
I would agree completely with both of those sets of comments. I think we're focused on the local, but this is a national problem. This is, again, a community that is not well vaccinated. Not only has that community at risk, it puts other communities at risk as a reservoir for transmitting infection. And I think one of the things that would be very important is from the local level to talk with their congressperson, at the state level, a senator, to try and get federal support for this. And I completely agree with Richard, the need for long-term maintenance of that support and not an up and down kind of effort. And that's why I think trying to add on other issues such as an adult immunization program or other kinds of things could be helpful. And then again, building an infrastructure to deal with emergencies that we don't have very well in most areas right now.
I agree with all of the comments that people have made. And we're working on a pilot project with our San Diego Communivac site to mobilize funding and a funding strategy to support salaries for promotoras, community health workers, but also to sensitize local, state, and federal electeds to the issues at hand. And so when we look at the budgets of all of our local communities, public health gets maybe a tenth of what law enforcement gets. And that's mirrored at the federal level. CDC gets maybe 1/1000th of what the Defense Department gets. So we have to reprogram our funding allocations, and it can be done with this great boost from our federal funding right now, and then figure out how we build sustainable financial lives for health equity and health in all policies. And it's honestly, it's a possibility and within our reach right now.
Thank you so much, Arietta, Rich, Walt, and Tanae for those comments. We're going to encourage all of you to type in your questions in the chat box. And I'm going to turn this over to Emily, who's going to facilitate questions from our participants. It would be great to have some conversations between the local teams and the national working group. So local teams, you guys go ahead and ask your questions as well. So Emily, back over to you.
Thank you, Monica. And Liz and Stephen, I think that this set of questions will resonate with you in particular. This question about funding has come up twice, once from an anonymous participant and the other from Marielle Medipour. Thinking about funding, university systems, the federal government, local government, public health departments, and definitely communities all work on different timelines. Funding needs are not connected well. But it comes down to the point of, you know, when thinking about all of this and funding and making the argument that what we're doing is important and it's important to continue or that it is working, what are some short-term metrics that can be used to evaluate that, especially and in relation to community healthcare workers? There's been a lot of evaluation around the effectiveness of community health workers, but at what point should we stop highlighting the need to evaluate and then acknowledge the effectiveness of this workforce? So what can we do in terms of proving that things work, and especially in a community-driven scenario?
Right. I think marshaling the metrics that do exist, and it's pretty compelling, is one step. I do think, though, that especially at the local level, you know, in a budget process, oftentimes it's one picture or one graph or one or two numbers that swing the argument. I really think it's kind of relating the situation of the pandemic to decision makers and laying out for those people how community workers, I'll use the word force extender. It just so happens that, you know, if you imagine the roles that community health workers have, they can double task, they can serve multiple functions. You know, there may not be a translator in the department, but someone who's working in the field on behalf of the health department, this community health worker, can play that role of being a translator. And politicians like getting to their minority communities as well as majority communities. So I think that there's a bona fide case that can be made, and it's just at the level of common sense that and there has to be a career ladder also for community health workers. And I love the thought that they would go back to school and upgrade their credentials as well. But I think there's a pretty powerful case that could be made that when you look at your staff complement, that by hiring community health workers, even on an exploratory basis, that you're going to set up the ability to garner metrics, but also to marshal the evidence that exists when you make that pitch.
Well, I also wanted to take a moment to respond, and I do agree with everything that you said, Richard. I'm here in Tennessee, and we've been in the media lately. And I will say, in my previous position, I was director of the Office of Minority Health for the Tennessee Department of Health. So I had an opportunity to really have a perspective of what our legislators needed to be convinced that public health was worth investment in general, right? And so at the end of the day, it really is about the bottom line for some individuals. And so I think that there might be an opportunity to incorporate a health economist as part of the solution with regards to evaluating the effectiveness or the bottom line and how that could save the state healthcare dollars overall if we did have a community health workers workforce, if we did invest in public health overall. So I think it was, I forgot who it was, Elizabeth, it might've been you that mentioned that there was an effort to also engage elected officials and educate them about public health. So in addition to that, I think we also have to frame it in a way that legislators understand. And from my experience here in Tennessee, it helps to really target that bottom line in, with regards to cost savings that we could possibly have.
You know, I'm wondering if when we do the right thing, if it costs more, maybe the argument is also a moral one and not just cost savings. And then on the cost savings side, Tina, I'm saying if the vaccines are effective in preventing death and serious illness, right? What is the cost of one case in an ICU? It's a knowable number. If you take a look at it, we're talking hundreds of thousands of dollars. So why aren't we saying that every time we give a vaccine in the community at the local level, that that is X number of dollars saved? Why doesn't that argument work as well, especially in the moment of COVID? Because now we know by averting people ending up in the hospital, we're saving hundreds of thousands of dollars. Why can't public health get credit for that? That's what I don't get about how we do our arguments. The other is there's a lot of guilt out there. We've met young people who did not get vaccinated, got sick, infected grandma. Grandma dies. They are guilty. We need a way for them to kind of deal with that. And that story in and of itself, combined with these other things, I think can help move the needle with these legislators. These are their constituents. And then last but not least, since I saw your story in Tennessee last night, how about all those elected officials who have been vaccinated and refused to tell their constituents? Why don't we tell their constituents they've been vaccinated? And then we can say, follow your leaders. We have to be more creative, because the other side is actively involved in very sophisticated strategies. And I don't think we're quite equal to it yet. Sometimes we don't even want to talk about it. Doesn't mean we have to go down the rabbit hole, but to ignore it is to ignore very powerful forces targeting the very communities we're talking about.
Stephen, you've said a lot there. And just on the first comment, the moral aspects of this, they are many and they are real. And I think that that information is available in terms of the preventive approaches that are used in both healthcare and in public health, and what the outcomes are if you don't do those things and what they cost the community. And also what Walter said in terms of viruses being not discriminating in terms of who they will infect in the community. So it's in everyone's interest. But I wanna jump from that to kind of the worst case scenario, because you said be creative and so on. And that is where you have a local health department in a community, I won't say what part of the country or whatever, because they're all over, but where the staff does not reflect the community, where the expertise and community skills is not there. Any fair person would say that. Then I think it really is a call for community action, which is hard in instances. I've always been amazed when a large hospital shuts down that no one's out on the street protesting. People don't feel empowered. But in this area, particularly on the heels of COVID, it gets down to communities organizing and having a basis to really make their voice heard. Tough thing, but there are ways to do it. And I think in those communities where it's at ground zero, it's incumbent on anybody who has access to that community in any way, shape, or form to arm them. I always like the thought of a force field analysis, that you look in the community of who's for doing what's right, who's against it, how do you neutralize who's against it, how do you bulk up the parts of the community that can take action. Politicians are know when that happens, and when the community does that, there's going to be some response. At least it will shake things up. So I think in the worst case, you have to use all the strategies you spoke to and more, but that's a case where you could wait around for 20 years and there may not, even if there's funding there, it may not be applied to the things that health department needs to do if it's going to function as a health department to improve community health.
Thank you, Rich.
I could reinforce that. I was going to say that having been at the national level, formal cost-benefit analysis, economic analysis, was very, very helpful. I think it would be important to invest in that. So I would like to agree with what Penny said in terms of doing that. And I think the other issue I think Stephen mentioned is the issue, my boss at CDC used to say, anecdata will always beat real data. The issue is to get anecdata that illustrate real data and to try and get some of these stories and put them in perspective so that it can motivate people.
So we're almost at time, but Liz and Noe, your comments?
I've worked with community health workers now for almost 30 years, 10 years down on the US-Mexico border. And I would really like to emphasize something that Richard said, that, and I think it was reflected on something that I'd said a little bit earlier, that the community health worker cannot be seen as a band-aid to fix everything. They will be the lowest paid person on the totem pole. they will have no job security. I have seen people in these roles over the years not advance. The way that you can make it work is to have it embedded within a university setting. We actually have this at my university. It needs refining, but it needs to be a ladder, an intellectual ladder to a more professional level, a BSN, or to be a mid-level practitioner, or to go on to be a doctor or a, you know, any other level of healthcare professional. And that is how you change, like Richard said, what the public health department looks like. That's how you change how all these things look like, is by getting more and more people into that professional level of economic and intellectual functioning.
Thank you. So Noe and then Daniela.
Briefly, if I can add just to the conversation of the huge value added by community health workers. Often the label that's used to describe communities is hard to reach. And oftentimes my response is hard to reach for whom? And that is that the community health worker is really the workforce that is able to reach, invigorate and create action that otherwise does not happen. So I think that that's an important consideration.
So Daniela, we're at time, but if you wanna just add your.
No, I didn't have a comment other than to agree with everything that's been said here.
Thank you. So Monica, and thank you all. I'll turn this over to Monica to close us out.
Thanks to our panelists, both from the first half and the second half, and thanks to all of you for joining us. Just to be quick, the country needs to seize this moment to achieve widespread and lasting COVID-19 vaccine coverage, including among the most vulnerable groups. But we can also be developing locally appropriate mechanisms that advance equity in health along the way. So let's act in ways that are both urgent and essential. And all of us at the Communivax Coalition wish you well and thank you for your participation. Take care.
Wear your mask.